choir, excellent stuff. Children, you're dismissed at this time with Kiss Ahoy. I'm out here at the front door. Glad you guys are here. Glad you all have joined us here at Woodside Community Church. I'm glad to be back with all of you. Last week was really good. I got to go be with the old family and preach, and we got to have Pastor Ed here, and I always cherish getting him to come and preach the word to you guys. So that was excellent, and it's really good to have some functioning air conditioning, right? We're not completely roasting. I see some fading. Here's the secret. Come this way. Sit in the front. Stop sitting in the back, and it's much cooler up here. We're halfway done. The back units aren't working yet. These are working, so we can still survive today. But it will be even cooler once we get all of them together. Man, it's exciting. God's been very good to us. It feels nice and cool. This one blows like right on me. It's wonderful. So this is the most comfortable spot. So God is good, and that's what we're going to look at this morning. We're going to look at how He's good. We want to see what Scripture tells us about that goodness. So take out your Bibles and turn to the book of Psalms, and turn to Psalm number 2. We are spending our whole summer looking at these 3,000-year-old poems and songs and seeing what are these things? What do they teach us about God? How can we use these psalms? Well, this one is really, really important. Psalm 2 is one of the most frequently cited psalms in the New Testament. And as we said last time, how it and Psalm 1 together serve as the introduction to the whole book. And if you're already there, notice how that last line starts in Psalm 2. It starts with the word what? Blessed. We've looked at that word already, because that's the first word of Psalm chapter 1. So we start with blessing, and we end with blessing. In fact, in Acts 13:33, Paul quotes Psalm 2, verse 7, and he says, as it is written in the second psalm, and then he quotes the verse. But in a couple of the Greek manuscripts, the Greek of Acts 13 actually says, as it is written in the first psalm, and then he quotes Psalm 2, 7. Which implies to us that there was a time in the past when Psalm 1 and Psalm 2 were not separate, but were together. But these were one psalm that eventually got split. So these two are the most important because they are the foundational beginning psalms that kind of set the stage for everything that's going to come in the rest of the 148 other psalms. So last week we looked at, last time we looked at Psalm 1 and the way of the righteous. We looked at the blessed life, which is the meditating life, which is the life that is planted and nourished by God. We looked at stability and productivity and prosperity, the spiritual prosperity. And it's the way of the righteous, we saw, versus the way of the wicked. And the psalm ends with the wicked will perish. Righteous prosper, wicked perish. And these are the two ways of life, and the only two ways of life. And by putting that psalm first, we're being told, hey, pay attention, this is really important. You've got to know which one you are. Which path are you on? Which people are you? One leads to death, one leads to life. There is no third option. But then we get to Psalm 2, and what Psalm 2 does, in a sense, is it takes the lens and it kind of pulls back the camera. Right? Psalm 1 is personal, small scale, little picture, and you. Psalm 2 is cosmic. Large scale, big picture, it is everyone. Psalm 2 is going to give us a theological perspective for interpreting the entirety of world history. Now, I intentionally try to not talk about God's sovereignty all the time because I'm aware that it's one of my favorite topics and I can end up harping on it and talking about it too much. So I've intentionally tried to lay off of it a bit, but that would be impossible today because Psalm 2 is about God's sovereignty. Psalm 2 is about His rule and His reign, about His control over the world and over history. Psalm 2 is about kingship. God reigns. That's Psalm 2. Right, we're done. We can go home. It's going to take me 45 minutes to unpack for you how and why God reigns. So I talk about that a lot, how God is in absolute control of everything that happens, that nothing happens outside of His plan, that everything is going exactly as He designed it to go. I teach that because I believe that the Bible clearly teaches that. But then, sometimes, when we take our eyes off of the Bible and we put our eyes on the news, it's hard sometimes not to wonder, really in control? Right? Is He really good? Is He really ruling and reigning? Like, look at the havoc being wreaked by ISIS, not only in the Middle East, but now in Europe, and now even over here. Look at the current political process and the unprecedented chaos of this presidential election. it looks like we're stuck with two pretty equally terrible candidates, one of which will become the most powerful person in the world. But if you watch the late news at night, it's hard to go to bed very encouraged. There was a huge article in the New York Times front page last week about the chaos in Chicago. You can keep it up with what's going on in Chicago. Chirac is what it's called, according to Nicole. I didn't know that was a thing. She called it Chirac. But over Memorial Day weekend last week, in 3 days, there were 64 shootings and 6 people killed in just that city and a couple of neighborhoods. Sometimes it seems like chaos and suffering and death reign. Sometimes it seems like arrogant and loud leaders that act as if they are kings, guys like Trump and like Putin, rule the day. Does God really reign? Is he the king? Is he in control? That's the question that Psalm 2 is going to tackle. And it's going to do so in terms of kingship. As we don't have many kings these days, the world used to be dominated by kings, but the principle of kingship is still alive. Right? The king is simply the one that rules and that has authority and the one to whom we give allegiance. We may not have literal kings anymore, but we all have some king that dominates our lives, that we bow down and serve and give allegiance to. We make kings out of politicians, out of celebrities, out of athletes. We make kings out of institutions, out of wealth, out of pleasure. There is some king over your life. Psalm 2 is going to show you who the only true king is, what we've done to him, and what God has done in response. So we're going to break this down into three simple parts, verses 1 through 3. We're going to see how the rulers, the nations, how all of us, I'm going to argue, hate and reject God and his king. Then in verses 4 through 9, we'll see God's response to this. He is going to affirm and establish his king. And in verses 10 through 12, we'll see how God still graciously offers us a way out. How he still calls us to come to him and be reconciled to him. So we reject the king, God establishes the king, but then God still offers that king. That's what we're going to look at. Let me read it for you. This is the most important part. We just looked at 1 Timothy chapter 4 in Sunday school. Devote yourself to the public reading of Scripture. That's what we're going to do right now. Make sure that what I'm saying corresponds with this. So I invite you to look down at your copy of the Scripture, Psalm chapter 2, and follow along as I read it for you. This is God's Word. Why do the nations rage and the peoples plot in vain? The kings of the earth set themselves, and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed, saying, let us burst their bonds apart and cast away their cords from us. He who sits in the heavens laughs. The Lord holds them in derision. Then he will speak to them in his wrath and terrify them in his fury, saying, as for me, I have set my king on Zion, my holy hill. I will tell of the decree. The Lord said to me, you are my son. Today I have begotten you. Ask of me, and I will make the nations your heritage, and the ends of the earth your possession. You shall break them with a rod of iron, and dash them in pieces like a potter's vessel. Now therefore, O kings, be wise. Be warned, O rulers of the earth. Serve the Lord with fear, and rejoice with trembling. Kiss the Son, lest he be angry, and you perish in the way. For his wrath is quickly kindled. Blessed are all who take refuge in him. Bow with me, let's begin with the word of prayer. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for the privilege of getting to stand here and to proclaim your word. Father, there's nothing within me that qualifies me to do that. Father, there's nothing worthy in me to get to stand here and to proclaim your word. Father, but I know that your word is living and it's active. Father, I know that you speak and that you work through your word. So we ask right now for your Holy Spirit to come and to wake us up, to open our eyes and our ears, to focus our minds for the next few minutes on your word. Help us to see and understand what we have done and what you have done in response. Father, help us to see our rejection of you. Father, I hope that we would most see your gracious offer of your King, Jesus Christ, to us. Father, show us Christ this morning through your word. And I ask and pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I love how this psalm starts. Why? Why? If you'll notice over in Psalm chapter 3, there's a heading under it that says a Psalm of David. If you look back at Psalm chapter 2, you'll notice that that's not there in chapter 2. But as we read in Acts chapter 4, the apostles, when they are quoting this psalm, say, as David wrote this. Right? So they're saying that David wrote this under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. So David wrote Psalm 2, I assume Psalm 1 then as well. But I love how David starts. He's astonished. He's perplexed. He's flummoxed. What are you guys doing? Can't you see? Don't you understand the futility of what you are plotting and planning? Which is what? What are these guys plotting? Let's start in verse 3. Let us burst their bonds and cast away their cords. It's quite simply a rejection of God and His kingdom, of God's rule and reign. This is cosmic rebellion. This is the throwing off of a king and his authority. When we think of a rebellion like this, we think of the American Revolution. July 4th, somehow, is only a couple of weeks away. I don't know how that happened. But every year, at this time, I try and read some book related to the American Revolution. So this year, I just started reading the book Alexander Hamilton. When it showed up in the mail, it was a lot bigger than I thought it was going to be. That was discouraging, but I'm working on it. This is the book behind the much-hyped Broadway show, Hamilton, that I've been trying for a year to get tickets to, and it's impossible. So if any of you want to get tickets to that show, go ahead, that would be awesome. But Hamilton was one of the senior aides to George Washington, the general in the war, and then he ascended to become, I think, BJ's favorite founding father, as he was the one behind kind of central government and big banks and all these things that BJ loves. But anyways, the revolution was a rebellion against the king that was treating the people unjustly, right? The people were suffering greatly under the distant reign of a foreign king, and they rose up to overthrow him and to remove themselves from his authority. That is basically what Psalm 2 is saying that we have done to God, except this king, God, is not some cruel, distant tyrant lording his rule unjustly over people. No, he is. He's good. And he is benevolent. As we'll see in a few weeks in Psalm 103. Psalm 103 is my favorite psalm. It's the psalm I'm most excited about preaching. Listen to how Psalm 103 describes this God that we have thrown off. Here's what Psalm 103 says. Forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquity, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit, who crowns you with steadfast love and mercy, who satisfies you with good. He works righteousness and justice for the oppressed. He is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. He does not deal with us according to our sins. Great is his steadfast love toward us. He shows compassion to us, and it just goes on and on and on. This is the God that we are talking about. This is the king. This is the one that we have rejected and rebelled against. It's insane. It's illogical. It's ridiculous. And that's why David starts off, why? What are you doing? Are you stupid? You are rejecting him. And look at who's doing the rebelling in verses 1 and 2. Look at the different names we get. We get the nations, we've got the peoples, we've got the kings, and we've got the rulers. In other words, it's all of us. We have rejected the king. I have rejected the king. The world hates God. It conspires against him, and it wants nothing to do with him. You know who Richard Dawkins is, right? You know who Richard Dawkins is? He's a professor over at Oxford. He's probably the most famous scientist of our time. In 2013, he was actually voted the world's top thinker. That's impressive. I was hoping to win that, but not. Richard Dawkins won it. So Richard Dawkins is this great influential person. He's this world leader. He's this outspoken atheist. Here's what the world's top thinker writes about God in his book, The God Delusion. He writes, this poem is even hard for me to read, but here's what he writes. Let's understand what Psalm 2 is talking about. He says, the God of the Old Testament is arguably the most unpleasant character in all fiction, jealous and proud of it, a petty, unjust, unforgiving, control freak, a vindictive, bloodthirsty, ethnic cleanser, a misogynistic, homophobic, racist, infanticidal, genocidal, filicidal, pestilential, megalomaniacal man, sadomasochistic, capriciously malevolent. That's hatred, right? He seems quite angry at the God that he says he doesn't believe that exists. Which doesn't make a lot of sense to me, right? I've never been angry at a unicorn because unicorns don't exist. But I get angry about that. It seems that maybe the anger that he has towards God is actually evidence of God's very existence. Dawkins despises God. That's Psalm 2. There's another guy, Thomas Nagel. He lives right across the river. He's a professor NYU. He's my favorite atheist. He's an honest atheist. His book, Mind and Cosmos, is brilliant. Everyone should read it. And in that book, he admits that Darwinian evolution, as it's taught today, as we know it, simply makes no sense. He says this doesn't explain anything. He got in a lot of trouble for saying this. Go read that book. It's really good. But he also admits that he hates God. In an earlier book, he writes, I speak from experience, being strongly subject to this fear myself. I want atheism to be true, and I'm made uneasy by the fact that some of the most intelligent and well-informed people I know are religious believers. It isn't just that I don't believe in God and hope that I'm right. It's that I hope there is no God. I don't want there to be a God. I don't want the universe to be like that. It's hatred, right? That's dislike and disgust and attempt to throw off God and His kingdom. Plotting in vain, conspiring against God. Hatred. So many rulers and empires have tried to stamp out God's church and to do away with Him. Started right away with Rome. Russia has tried it. China has tried it. It's trying to, culturally, it's starting today. It keeps happening, and it keeps failing. They hate God, and they try to throw Him off. But listen, don't think that, oh, it's just, all right, it's just these world leaders, it's just the famous atheists. No, 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 this is all of us. All right, we live in the land of the free. We live in the land where personal freedom and autonomy to do whatever we want, whenever we want, with whomever we want, is gospel truth. Again, don't think everyone out there. Think us. We hate authority. We hate rules. We hate regulations. We hate limitations on our freedom. And that's more what verse 3 is about, by the way. The cords and bonds language can imply that mean old God has us locked up and chained up. But that's not what the Hebrew means. The Hebrew more is the idea of a yoke. The idea of the fact that God, as our Creator, has authority over us and has the right to tell us to do and how to live. And we loathe that fact. We reject the thing. We may not think that we're raging and plotting and taking counsel, but whenever we buy into the world's way of placing self and satisfaction before all else, we become the kings and the nations of Psalm 2. We set ourselves up against God. We act as His enemies as we attempt to throw off His rule and His reign. Whenever we refuse Him and to do what He has called us to do, whenever we willfully choose sin and what dishonors Him, we reject the King. When I can sit and start to look around and examine my circumstances and grumble and complain, when I say, man, how could you give this to that person and not me? I'm trying to reject the King. In seminary, I had two buddies. I had more than two buddies. There were two guys I had classes with, three at least. There were two guys I had classes with, one of which now has published a book, which has done very, very well, and the second of which is pastoring a church of like 3,000 people now down in North Carolina. And there's a temptation sometimes to say, what's the deal? Come on, God. I got better grades than those guys. I was better looking than both of them. This, that, and the other. And I can, if I let myself, can start to sit and to stew and to look and think and say, God, you've obviously gotten it wrong. And I am discontent, and I am dissatisfied, and I am angry, and I am attempting to remove the King. And I am attempting to place myself in that position. So we all do this. We reject the King and we try and assert ourselves as the King. Have you ever heard of a guy named George MacDonald? George MacDonald was a Scottish pastor in the 19th century. He's very famous. He wrote a lot of really good fantasy and kids books. He was very influential to guys like C.S. Lewis and Tolkien. Some of his theology was a little bit problematic, but he also had some very profound things to say. Listen to what MacDonald writes about what it is that we're talking about here. Here's what he says. I like this. He says, the one principle of hell is, I am my own. I am my own king and my own subject. I am the center from which go out my thoughts. I am the object and end of my thoughts. My glory is and ought to be my chief care. My ambition to gather the regards of men to the one center, myself. My pleasure is my pleasure. My judgment is the rule of things. My right is what I desire. The more I am all in all to myself, the greater I am. The more self-sufficient I am, the greater I am. I will be free with a freedom that consists in doing whatever I want. To do my own will, so long as I feel anything to be my will, is to be free it is to live. This is the one principle of hell. I am my own king. That's all too. That's profound. That's insightful. And that's, listen, that's your heart and that's my heart as well. We demand our way. And when we do so, we are rejecting his way. And when we reject his way, we reject him and his king. And to reject the rightful king is to oppose him and to become enemies of the king. This is a problem. And if you reject and you rebel against the king, you get thrown into prison or you get killed. We have rejected the king of the universe. Not really. Look at how God responds. Let's start with verse 10. We have been doing the speaking in verse 3. Now God, here himself, speaks in verse 10. As for me, I have set my king on Zion, my holy hill. This is God's response to our rejection and rebellion. He establishes his king. Go back to the end of verse 2, and let's learn a little bit more about this king. Notice that we have rebelled not only against God, but also against his anointed. For the first time we've seen this. In Psalm chapter 1, we were introduced to God, the Lord. Remember, whenever you see in the Old Testament, Lord, in all capital letters, the Hebrew behind that is not the Hebrew word Lord, it is Yahweh. It's God's personal name. But here all of a sudden, we're introduced to another person. We've had Yahweh, now we've got Yahweh's anointed. And the Hebrew for anointed is Mashiach. You hear? Mashiach. That's where we get our word Messiah, which is the same word for Christ. Mashiach, Messiah, Christ. All the same thing. And the word means anointed one. The one who was chosen and set apart. Now listen, sometimes it takes some effort and work to get to Jesus from Old Testament passages, which we should always do because Jesus tells us himself that the Old Testament is about him. John 6:39, he says, you search the scriptures. And again, he's talking in a time when they only had the Old Testament. So he says, you search the Old Testament because you think that in them you have eternal life. It is they that bear witness about me. The Old Testament's about Jesus. Now, sometimes it's a little more difficult to figure out. Not here. And in John 1, when Andrew first meets Jesus, he rushes to introduce his brother Peter to Jesus, and Andrew cries out, we have found the Messiah. Jesus is the ultimate and final anointed one. Now, yes, there is a sense in which any king sitting on the throne of David was anointed with oil. He was declared to be the king. He was referred to as the anointed one. So the psalm does apply in some limited sense historically to those kings. But it's clear that as you start looking at the psalm and reading it, there's something more here. Right? There's a prophetic dimension. It's clear that there are bigger things going on and things that are said of this anointed one that can be fulfilled by no earthly king. The scope of Psalm 2 calls for one who is far more than a mere man. Look at verse 7. Now the anointed one himself is speaking. He's proclaiming his relationship with God. He is God's son. And that can only truly be said about one individual. Thus, when you get to the book of Hebrews in the New Testament, the author there takes Psalm chapter 2, verse 7, and writes this verse and says, hey, by the way, this verse is about Jesus and how he is superior to all else. That's what Hebrews is about, by the way. Jesus is better. That's the book. And then after that, the author proceeds to go through five different passages of the Psalms and attribute every one of those things to being about Jesus. Right? The Psalms are about Jesus. And this one is clearly about Jesus. Look at verse 8. It says, I will make the nations your heritage and the ends of the earth your possession. But what earthly king could this be true? None. Right? No king has inherited all the nations. No kingdom has spread from one end of the earth to the other. Only Jesus. Only his kingdom. God's response to the rebellion of the people is to affirm and to establish his kingdom. All the plotting, all the posturing, God's not concerned. He's not worried. We tend to get pretty worried, but that's because we forget Psalm 2. We forget who it is that we claim to follow. I was reading a book this week on evangelism. It was excellent. It's called Jesus the Evangelist. And the point of the book is basically, let's look at how Jesus does evangelism in the book of John, and then we should model our evangelism after him instead of after all the tricks and the gimmicks that people are doing these days. Well, listen to what the author writes related to what we're talking about. He says, the things that make front page news are of comparatively little interest to Jesus. What rulers are decreeing, what polls are showing, what stock prices are doing, much less sports scores, are affairs of the worldly kingdom, but not of Christ's kingdom. During Jesus' life, he paid no attention to military, political, or economic affairs, but he wearied himself down the Samaritan road to save the soul of this one woman at the well. Should this not challenge our own priorities and interests? As we obsess over the news, I obsess over sports. We freak out about politics. Right? Well, what's going to happen if Trump wins? It's going to be the end of civilization as we know it. Hillary's probably evil incarnate. She's probably the Antichrist. We're doomed if she is president. And we worry and we wring our hands and we despair. But what does God do in the face of all this wickedness and chaos? Verse 4. He laughs. He's unimpressed. He is unconcerned. The things that we obsess over, he pays little attention to. He is far more concerned with what is going on in here, in his church, among his people. He is far more concerned with his kingdom than the passing kingdoms of the world. His priorities are different than our priorities, and he is not worried about the course of history, and he is not concerned about the direction of our nation. And he laughs. He holds his opponents in derision. Derision means ridicule. It means mockery. That's God's response to all of the great schemes of the great men in the world. That is his response to our attempts to overthrow him. Now listen, we may not be entirely comfortable with the imagery of God laughing and mocking people, but the message is clear. God is so great. His power is so great and his position so secure that he need not take any coalition of man, as great and powerful as those men may be, as serious threats to him and his rule. There is no threat to God. So he laughs. How can there be no threat? How can he laugh at such things? It's simply because of who he is, right? He is God. He's the king. He's the creator. He's the ruler, and he is sovereign. One of the mottos frequently repeated in our house. If you're in our home for 2 or 3 hours and our children are there, you will hear this at some point every single day. Here's what we say at least once a day: you don't always get what you want. Right? I would watch Frozen, Tangled, and Wreck-It Ralph all in a row, and I would do it with candy in my lap. You don't always get what you want. That is unless grandparents are involved. I had some stuff on Friday morning. Melissa had a doctor's appointment, so we left our girls. Melissa's dad and his wife, and apparently they watched one show, and then Lila asked for another show, and they just kind of turned it on, and Lila looked at him and said, "You're easy." So other than when grandparents are around, we make it clear to our kids that they do not always get what they want. They're especially learning that they never get what they want when they complain or when they pitch a fit. They actually end up getting the opposite when that's what they do. We're teaching them, this is not how you get what you desire. So we're trying to tell them, you do not always get what you want. And so when we tell them that, the next thing I ask them, I say, "Well, does daddy always get what he wants?" And they're running. "No." They're tired of this. And then say, "Well, does mommy always get what she wants?" "No." The question I always ask is, who is the only person who always gets what he wants? God. That's sovereignty. That's what we're trying to teach our kids. The king always gets what he wants. And the creator king of the universe especially always gets what he wants. And what happens is always and only what he wants to happen. That's sovereignty. God rules and he reigns. Let me give you a couple of passages just to confirm this. The book of Daniel is a great example of Psalm chapter 2. Daniel is a book all about God's sovereignty. Nebuchadnezzar, besides having an awesome name, is the king of Babylon, and he has absolutely just wrecked Jerusalem. He has taken the people off into captivity. He's the most powerful man in the world, and he seems to have utterly defeated Israel and Israel's God. If ever there was a time for panic, that was the time. Circumstances could not have been worse. Things could not have looked more out of control, and evil could not have had more of an advantage. But in chapter 5 of the book of Daniel, God shows up, and God humbles the most powerful man in the world. God makes him into nothing. And then once God restores him, Nebuchadnezzar gets it. And this king, this most powerful man in the world, proclaims, he says, I bless the Most High and praise and honor him who lives forever. For his dominion is an everlasting dominion, and his kingdom endures from generation to generation. All the inhabitants of the earth are accounted as nothing, and he does according to his will among the host of the heavens and among the inhabitants of the earth, and none can stay his hand or say to him, what have you done? That's powerful. That's from the lips of the greatest king of that time. God does what he wants. No one can stop him. You don't even have the right to question him. Then there's Psalm 135:6, whatever the Lord pleases, he does. There's Isaiah 46:9, for I am God, and there is no other. I am God, and there is no one like me. I declare the end from the beginning, and from ancient times, things not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will accomplish all my purposes. I have spoken, and I will bring it to pass. I have purposed, and I will do it. Right? In Psalm 2:2, the wicked are taking counsel against God together. In Isaiah 46:9, God declares that his counsel and his counsel alone shall stand. Not even clear. The end from the beginning. He will bring to pass what he has planned, and nothing can stop him. He laughs at our attempts to rebel against him. He's unfazed. God has established his Messiah King, Jesus, and none can unseat him. None can rival him. All is well, even when things look their worst. Like when Babylon conquered. Like when the whole tide of our culture seems to be going against us. Like when the wicked men nailed God's Messiah King to a cross. God was still in control. As we read in the scripture reading this morning from Acts chapter 4, it's Psalm 2 that the apostles quote about Jesus and the cross, about the Gentiles raging and Herod and Pilate plotting against God and his Messiah. That's ultimately fulfilled in Jesus. And they continue in verse 28 and say, these people were gathered to do whatever your hand and your plan had predestined to take place. It is actually the cross that most demonstrates God's sovereignty. He planned it. He purposed it. When things looked to be at their darkest, God was most in control, working the most good out of the most evil thing that has ever happened. God reigns. We rebel, but God has established his kingdom, and he will not be moved. Last point, real quick. Now listen. Everybody likes the idea of God. No one is opposed to the idea of God, except very few people. Everyone likes the God who is love. People love a God that they can control and shape and make whatever they want him to be. People love the God that doesn't really interfere, kind of more like a Santa Claus God, like, oh, you're good, great, you're good, okay. But deep down, most of us, if we're honest with ourselves, we bristle at the truth that God is King, that God is Lord, that God rules and reigns and creates and judges, who demands that we submit to him or perish. You can talk about God and be like, oh yeah, okay, I believe in God, until you start talking about that stuff. We hate that because we want to be king. We want to rule and to reign. We want things to go how we plan them to go, but that doesn't work. Why? Because there's already a king. And if in reality there is already a king and we reject that king, we become his enemy. Guys, we can't change reality. God exists. Jesus is the king. And thus, the only two options are to fall down and submit to him or to double down and oppose him. But he will win. Look at verse 9. Verse 9 it's pretty graphic. I haven't spent a ton of time on it. He will crush his enemies. Right? He is the righteous and the just king. He must defeat evil and wickedness. And we're all like, yeah, definitely defeat ISIS and Hitler and all those bad, terrible things. But to oppose him is the height of evil and wickedness. We love that God is against evil and wickedness until we realize that that includes us. But I want you to see, really, let's focus at the end and let's get what God does here in the beginning. This is amazing. Look at verses 10 through 12. In spite of all the rebellion, in spite of all the rejection, and plotting, and counseling, and raging, in spite of the fact that I hate God and that you hate God, what does he mean? He still offers you his kingdom. He still offers you redemption. redemption and reconciliation and forgiveness and life. After all of these guys have done, what do these verses say? Be warned. Be wise. Serve the Lord. Kiss the Son. God's holding out. Go away. He's saying, no, no, listen, listen. Come. Submit. Kiss the Son. And kiss the Son, all it means is, you know, back in the day, the Robin Hood, old Disney park, you remember, they had to kiss Prince John's ring, and Robin steals the ring, the jewels out of the ring. And you kiss the rings of kings, right? It was a way that you showed your submission. So this call here to kiss the Son is simply a call to submit to Him, which really just means give up, surrender, lay down your arms, cease the futile rebellion against Him, and come to Him. That's all kiss the Son means. After all we've done, God still holds out an offer. He still holds out the offer of His good and His righteous King to us. If only we will turn from ourselves and rest in Him. He offers the King who we will see in later Psalms, and as we see so clearly in the Gospel, who doesn't come first to break and to dash His enemies in pieces. But He comes first to be broken and dashed into pieces Himself for His enemies. See, His people rejected Him. They made themselves enemies of God and His King, but then that King first comes to take their place, to take their penalty, and to die their death. This is the King that God offers. This is the one He asks us to submit to, a King of love and mercy and grace, a King who would go to any length to rescue His people, even if it meant giving His own life for His people. The King dies for His servants. The King dies for His enemies. That's the Gospel. And that was God's plan to rescue us. Not because we were good or beautiful, but because He is good and beautiful. Look at verse 12. If you persist in making Him your enemy, you will perish. So there's no way around it. He is just. He is the King. And if we reject Him, we choose death. But if you submit, there's that word again. There's blessing. There's satisfaction. There's fulfillment. There's life. He is the King. There's no way around that. There is no refuge from Him. There is only refuge in Him. He is the conquering King. He is the righteous warrior. He is the just judge that must punish sin and that must punish rebellion. And there is no escape from Him except in Him. Guys, our only hope is to kiss the Son, to give up and to rest in Him and the work that He did for us in His life and in His death and in His resurrection. Here's your one application to take home. I want you to chew on this, and then we'll be done. I want you to take this question and meditate on it this week. We just spent months in 1 John on the question of, how do you know? How do I know that I'm a Christian? Well, how can I tell? What are some of the signs? Well, actually, here's one of the ways. This is a weird one. I really like this one. This is going to sound strange. Are you aware of the fact that you hate God? Are you aware of that? Have you seen that? Have you felt that rejection and that rebellion rear its ugly head in fight and rage in your heart? Have you had those desperate internal battles over your desire to throw off the yoke and to reject the King and to establish yourself as the King? If you have, then you're probably a Christian. Right? This seems so counterintuitive, but if you know that you have it within you to hate and to rage against God, if you're aware of that part of you, then you're a Christian. Because only Christians know that. If you aren't aware, here's the warning. Here's where I want some of you to really pay attention. If you aren't aware that sometimes you hate God and that you have rejected Him and that you have tried to overthrow Him, if you're not aware of that fact, then you definitely do hate God. Right? It seems like it should be the opposite, doesn't it? But no, it's not. Because if you're aware that this is a struggle of yours, then it's evidence that God is doing something. It's evidence that God's Spirit is now coming into what was a fortress of only hatred, and He is now ruling and reigning and taking over and pushing that out. But there's still that war going on within you. And that struggle is a really, really good sign. Right? But listen, if you haven't been made aware of the fact that you have hated and rejected God in His name, man, that's a wake up. That's a pay attention. Like, are you aware of your sin? Are you aware of this tendency within you? Examine your heart and let it show you what your relationship to Him and what that is. And so what a gracious King that rescued us when we had made ourselves His enemy. And hey, we just sang it. I loved singing it. It was so comforting and encouraging to sing this all through this morning. Great is thy faithfulness. So that even once we rejected Him and He came for us and He rescued us and redeemed us, even then, when we still struggle and sometimes fight to throw off and return from Him, great is thy faithfulness. He pursues us and He loves us and He works with us and He is patient with us. Great is thy faithfulness. This is Him. This is the one that we are called to submit to. It's easy, right? It's love. Right? You have to marry your wife. Christ wants it, right? I'm glad I get to marry my wife. You have to submit to the King. This is who the King is. The King who came to live and to die for His people. That's the gospel. Bow with me. Let's close with the word. Father, thank you for your word. Father, thank you for this time where we can come and be together. Father, I love your people. Father, I love your church. I love getting to sing your praises with them, to be encouraged by them, and to encourage them. Father, thank you for the church. This family and this body of people who had all made themselves, ourselves, your enemy, but that you have come for and rejected and now fashioning and shaping into a people, a family. A bunch of different people who are all united around your King Jesus Christ. Father, I pray that we would see the hatred and the rejection in our hearts. Father, if we don't know you, I pray that we would see that for the first time, and that you would save us and bring us from death to life. Father, if we do know you, Father, I pray that we would be aware of that indwelling sin that remains and of our desire to assert ourselves as King, to go our way and to go instead of your way. Father, we cling to your faithfulness. We cling to the cross. We cling to the fact that Jesus Christ is a loving, merciful, and kind Savior. So I thank you for rescuing us. Help us in this series of the Psalms. Help us to see Him and understand Him so much more fully. Father, it's in Christ that you are most clearly revealed to us. Father, it's at the cross that both your justice and your love are so perfectly displayed. Just in that you must still punish sin. Father, merciful, that you punished your Son instead of us. Help us to love and delight.